On behalf of Ireland, I welcome you all to Day 3 of the Ireland International Conference for Responsible Management Education and Practice. Yesterday, our distinguished speakers from all walks of life and varied backgrounds shared their words of wisdom and some deep thoughts on the topic. We look forward to the same excitement and insightful knowledge sharing for today's sessions also. Moving towards our fifth session, I invite Dr. P. Dwarkanath, Dr. Sunil Rai, Dr. Mala Sinha, Mr. Sudipta Mandal, Ms. Ranjini Mata, and Professor Yavar Ehsan to the stage, please. Request the audience to keep their mobiles on mute, please. I request Professor Yavar Ehsan to take us through the session overview and introduce our esteemed speakers. Thank you.
Mr. Dwarkanath, Dr. Sunil Rai, Professor Ranjini, Mr. Sudipto, distinguished guests of honor, faculty members, colleagues, and students, a very good morning to all and welcome to the final day's proceedings of this international conference. After a wholesome day yesterday, let us get started with the first session today. Good ethics is principled business. The theme of this session is an important component of responsible management education and practice. As part of our proceedings, we will look at various aspects of a need for ethics in business. Our discussion will include but not be limited to the importance of businesses having credibility leading to competitive advantage, non-financial reporting of organizations and how the public view they need to manage their brand and reputation, role of corporate citizenship and ethical concerns with respect to technology acceptance. Our esteemed panel members on the dais today have illustrious profiles which are available on the conference website as well as the conference brochure. However, let me briefly introduce them before we get started. Mr. P. Dwarkanath is the advisor, Group Human Capital of Max India Limited. He has experience of more than 4 decades, of which he has spent 27 years with GlaxoSmithKline. Dr. Sunil Rai is the director of the Goa Institute of Management. Previously, Dr. Rai was the Vice President at NIIT University at Neemrana. He has experience of 32 years in the field of general and technical management, largely with the Indian Navy. Ms. Ranjini Mata is Dean Academics at ILM Institute for Business and Management at Gurgaon. She is a qualified chartered accountant with over 12 years of corporate experience and 3 years of academic experience. Mr. Sudipto Mandal is a research scholar at the University of Burdwan, Department of Commerce. He will be presenting a paper co-authored by Professor Shantanu Kumar Ghosh, who is a professor of commerce at the University of Burdwan and also present here with us in the audience. It is a pleasure having you with us today. I would now request Mr. Dwarkanath to initiate the proceedings for the session.
Distinguished fellow panelists, distinguished guests, and distinguished delegates. Good morning to everybody. Good morning to everybody. It's a great honor and a privilege for me to be here to address this august gathering. When I was stepped into this institute today, I have been strong association with this institute in various capacities. But it's whenever I attend, normally I attend on a management seminar, typical topics like retention, leadership, succession planning, and so on, It's a great change today when I have accepted this invitation to be present here as one of the speakers. When they talked about ethics, credibility, which something, you know, which is very apt and relevant. I'm glad that ILM has taken this initiative and has been doing on an ongoing and a regular basis and a very sustained basis. It is not 1 year you're doing it for the sake of establishing your brand. It is not something, you know, is coming from the heart and the passion. So what I'm trying to say, you know, it's a great topic today, what you've been trying to discuss. I'm more trying to focus. I think we have a very distinguished panel, and the only hesitation and dilemma I have is I'm the only illiterate guy in this gathering, because all are academicians with the very strong credentials. But I talk from a very practical sense as a practicing manager of spending more than 4 decades. So that is my introduction about the topic. It's a great initiative. It's a very sustained effort, I was told by Mr. Rai, which is absolutely a great way of progressing. Management doesn't mean talking about marketing management, human resources management, financial management. Management encompasses very all pervasive. Very important that you need to be a rounded experience. Like, you know, in any function, you need to get the rounded experience of working in different facets, be it marketing, be it sales, be it human relations, or be it employee relations, be it cost management or strategic financial management or investments. I think it's important if you want to get a good citizen, corporate citizen. Good citizen, then good corporate citizen is important. You need to understand the ethics, the credibility, the integrity aspects, which are important. Sometimes you talk about it for the sake of talking it, but you never really mean what you said. So I want to just cover a few aspects about it. This is just a beginning, it's not an end, but I think we need to bring that awareness, especially in the Gen Y, who are the leaders of the Gen X, Gen Y, who are more into it, the millennial generation. I think in this context, it's important that we need to ensure and highlight this aspect as a part of the management curriculum. I think unless it starts from these schools, right from the not only business schools, even at a graduation or an undergraduate level, it will never reach. You can't suddenly make somebody understand what his ethics is. It has to be brought in. It's a part of the culture of the organization. That's why I just want to start. Culture eats strategy for breakfast. Culture is what? Is the way we work, is the way we live. It is a culture of ILM or a Max or a GlaxoSmithKline or for any other organization. It's a set of beliefs. That beliefs have to come from within the organization. I mean, what are the set of beliefs? If you see that, I have done a research on 30 top organizations, global organizations, when we were trying to drive what should be the values of the merged company of GlaxoSmithKline. I think it was a transformation change happening. Let us understand what is the values of the organization. When you set the mission of the organization and the purpose of the organization, our global quest is to improve the quality of human life by enabling people to grow more, longer, to do more, live longer, happier and healthier. It's a very easy statement. Every organization, every institution will have a great mission statement or a purpose statement. But the most important aspect is, do you really make walk the talk? It means whatever you said, it's nice to have them in your meeting halls, boardrooms, in your reception. But really, do you really implement what you have said? Do you walk the talk? I think that's where most of the organizations fail. And the organizations which can maintain, sustain, and enhance it further will move up. I just wanted to, what is credibility? What is brand building of an organization? I can give more examples from a corporate world rather than from the education, but same principles would apply. When GlaxoSmithKline has made that merger of Glaxo and SmithKline, they said our global quest is to improve the quality of human life. It's very easy to say quality of human life. Many people have said it, but what did they follow it up with that? The first action, you will be surprised to know, when they've done, That means we will only be involved in a science-based consumer products or research-based pharmaceutical products which can demonstrate, prove that they can enhance the quality of human life. So in the process, you will be surprised. They have disposed of 75 brands. Some of them are global brands. For example, if you see Yardley talcum powder, which is a very popular brand, it's a cash cow. It is not something brands, you know, which they were trying to hive off because they were suffering loss. I mean, sometimes you do as a business strategy, it's not so. Because this is to follow the in both in letter and spirit, the mission statement of the organization, the purpose of the organization. They disposed of all those brands, including Vilcream, which was a very popular brand. People were laughing, what is this? Are you running a business? No. Each company can have its own statement. For example, another global multinational said, we wanted to sell right from salt to ice cream. Everything from a mom and pop shop to a big stores. So that is the visibility of consumer products important for them. For this company, we wanted to take science-based consumer products. So whichever clinically cannot prove that it can add to human quality of human life, they are disposed of. And they survive and they sustain. So it is important what you say as a purpose, what you say as a mission, both as a human being, both as an organization, both an institution, you need to demonstrate it. There is no point in saying a value, I believe in integrity. Then you need to define, I think, you know, in ethics or in a credibility, what do you mean by integrity? The manifestation is important. It's very easy to say a list of laundry list, I believe in integrity, I believe in performance, I believe in innovation. It's easy to say, what do you mean by integrity? I just want to build on this. GlaxoSmithKline said, integrity for us means it's not just the financial integrity. That's one transactional aspect. Integrity means open and honest communication on a timely basis. That is what we believe. Then what did you do out of this? If you have a town hall meeting, do you have a town hall meetings? Many people have town hall meetings. But where is the sustainability comes in? When you do it consistently with a robust process. Doing a town hall meeting is not difficult. But when are you allow people to raise questions in the town hall meeting? And if they allow the questions, if you do an employee satisfaction survey or a student satisfaction survey or a teacher's satisfaction survey, do you announce the results? Some of them may not be in your favor. The scores may not show you exactly what you perceive. You have the ability, you have the courage to display that, both positives and negatives. Having said that, if some people, you form a committee, they try to evaluate these suggestions, do you have the courage to display those suggestions? And you may not implement anything for many good reasons, but it shows that your honest intentions, that you are a very credible institution, which you believe in what you say as your values and you, what you feel which is the right thing to do in terms of your mission statement. I think that gives a credibility. Why do you go for brand? You go for a brand because you feel you trust this brand. Whatever the unique selling proposition of this brand, it may be expensive brand, it may not be easily available, but still, you know, if you see a Merck, which is a particular model, if you say it takes 6 months to come, you wait for it. You don't jump to another car. I'm just saying whatever the car you like, because you feel this is a trustworthy company. They, whatever they say, they mean it, and they will deliver to your satisfaction. If there is an issue, you have a follow-up in terms of your customer backup. So I think that makes a difference. If you take in the management principles, in the 80s, there was a book written by Tom Peters, In Search of Excellence. And he has identified about 25 companies who are considered to be best in their practices, world class for many in different areas. See, by another 12 years, 15 years, most of the companies have vanished. Very few companies have survived. What is the reason? In those days, the reason was lack of sustainability in terms of delivery, in terms of performance. Earlier days, our slogan used to be in any organization, deliver what you promise. And number two, once you deliver, if you don't keep scoring, you are just practicing. I think, you know, it's important for anybody, whether it's a personal mission or an institutional mission, you need to have some measurements which has been agreed in advance and you track the measurements. But what happens in this competitive environment when you, everyone has become globalized after the collapse of the Berlin Wall and after the technology advancements, when globe has become a village, you know, world is flat, you know what happened? We become very commercial. I think the personal greed of the human being, be it in the corporate, be it in investment banking, be it in the corporate sectors, has overruled the need of the institution's interest or the corporate interest or the country's interest. In the process, if you just analyze what has, the shift was not lack of performance, it is lack of ethics and lack of governance, and in case of poor compliances, people tend to see how to beat the law rules rather than trying to see it, forget about the rules, but I would like to follow certain moral rules or guiding principles or a code of conduct. You see, when Tatas have introduced a PF, nobody asked them to follow the PF rules, but they have done it because they said that is the need of the hour. When DCM has introduced gratuity, Gratuity Act was nowhere there. But why they have introduced, that is something, you know, just following the law is not the issue. The issue is that is something beyond the law, something you be the role model, which you talk about some organizations, it makes a difference. Just to build on this brand building, I know we can keep talking it, but I think it's important from the corporate institutions why those companies have collapsed. What happened to Enron? It's a classic case of personal greed or lack of governance, collusion of many, many stakeholders, be it auditors, be it some of the CEOs and all that, which created that sort of a disaster. If you see, I used to show a slide in management that was rated one of the best companies, best sales force, one of the best sales force in world and one of the best sales force in US. What happened? Because few people can kill the organization due to lack of ethical practices, which no, it is nowhere exists. So just take the example. Today, we have been still suffering from global meltdown. If you just try to analyze, global meltdown has happened, according to me, not because we lacked anything in terms of our efforts or performance, but mainly because perhaps largely its contribute can be attributed to few people who are out of sheer greed have gone out of the way and manipulated the systems, physical systems of the globe for their own benefit perhaps. I think, you know, that has created why Lehman Brothers have collapsed in one day, why other companies were struggling with great difficulty they could survive, some of the major financial organizations globally, and what happened to Sachin, is all the examples of which you feel that it is not the law, it is not the regulations. Governments may impose, or SEBI can pass many laws, regulators can impose many, many restrictions. But if you want to beat it, there will be always smarter guys who tries to beat it. That it will not take you anywhere. So I think, you know, to sum it up, change is constant. And we are in this competitive environment, global environment. You need to gain, if you want to gain a competitive advantage today, it is only through people. Business growth is through people's growth. I think this is where the leadership is very important. And the sort of culture you develop, which is a set of beliefs and values are important, and you should make walk the talk. If you don't make the walk the talk, for example, I just want to give you one illustration. I think walk the talk requires a lot of courage from the top management, including the leaders. GRD Tata has opened Tata Management Center in 1996 at Pune. And when, in 66, when it was launched, first day the lunch, official lunch was taking place, there was an administrator, Colonel Koma, and he, JRD was entering the lunch room, he was stopped. And he said, "Sorry sir, you are not in a proper attire." Everybody was in a formal suit. When JRD always wears a safari, he was in a safari, he was just walking in after the ribbon cutting of the formal. "Sorry sir, you can't step in." "Sorry sir, you can't come in." He said, he looked at him, he said, "You are not in the proper attire." He said, "The Colonel, I don't have suits, I don't carry tie." "Sorry sir." And then he said, "In that case, we will send the lunch to your room." So JRD went back. JRD could have said, "What the bloody hell, and you are sacked." What you would have said, "You are in JRD position. What are you saying? You are humiliating me, you are sacked." I think, you know, I am not saying that requires, I am not praising Colonel Koma, but I am saying the greatness of that man, of JRD. He said, "Yes, walk the talk. It has to start from the top." Unless, you know, if you want to drive change, especially on ethics, and you have to give that passion, it can't be done by doing a drama. It has to come from within. It will come only when you demonstrate those sort of things. The other example, which you must have read it, Dr. Abdul Kalam has said it when he was a scientist. As you know, before the president, he was a scientist. He was a scientist, he was launching one of the missiles, very prestigious one. And he was all there, press was there, a lot of media attention. And Professor Satish Dhawan was his boss, he was his scientific advisor and secretary to the government of India, he was there. The launch took off, in their presence, it just collapsed. Total flop. You know, it can happen in the launch. So all the media guys, you know, media guys want, sorry, I hope there's no media. There's a sensationalized it. What happened, Professor? So Professor Abdul Kalam was shocked. He didn't know what to say. Meanwhile, Professor Satish Dhawan came and said, "You come to me, I'll tell you." He said, "Tell me who's responsible for this." He said, "I am responsible. Abdul has done his best, I am responsible." So I think he answered it. He went back. After comes sometime, again they relaunched. This time was a great success. So media rushed towards Professor Satish Dhawan. He said, "Please go and talk to Dr. Abdul Kalam. What does it show?" Okay, that's what the leadership is. Success has got many fathers. Failure is an orphan. And you know, this is where, you know, ethics also, you said, when the product is launched is successful, everybody takes credit. When the product launch is failed, everything, the blame is, you are trying to pass on the blame on who is the guy. That is not ethics. Ethics doesn't mean that I will be honest, I will be saying. These are the demonstrates, you know, in institution builders is one. Last bit before I close. Fundamentally, when you want to bring a key change, it's a transformation change you need to bring. It doesn't happen in one day. It's a journey. I think, you know, there are five key requisites. Very quickly. Organization as hero. Always believe people come and contribute. But ultimately, it's the organization which makes the change. What do you mean? If you say one of the most admired global companies in the world is GE, for leadership practices, for many things, we all quote. But Jack Welch has played a great role. But Jack Welch is not the hero. It is the GE. If you see Tata Steel, there are many people who contributed. They thought they are bigger than the Tata Steel. But, you know, it is not so. If you have to sacrifice sometimes, if it means ethics means, you need to sacrifice for the sake of institution. Your personal glory is secondary to the institutional welfare. That is what ultimately leads to the country and the corporates and so on. Second, winning attitude. You want to make the culture change or the ethics, it's a winning attitude. You need to have a personal resilience. Earlier we used to talk about Lance Armstrong. Now we don't talk about Lance Armstrong. Personal resilience, because it's ethical issues. Okay, you talk about Sudha Chandran, who lost her leg, but mission was to become a celebrated dancer, and she did. That is important. Number three, team learning. I think if you want to succeed in trying to drive ethics or the credibility of an organization and brand building, it can't be done by one person. It has to be done by a team. That is where, unfortunately, in India, even two players cannot play together. We want to be all single. Chess, shuttle, wrestling, boxing, shooting. Two great players of tennis, Linda Pace and Mahesh Bhupathi, had one together would have won many. Because this is a problem. In a pharmaceutical company where I spend all my life, we don't look for Nobel laureates. We look for team players. Because a drug discovery takes place with the help of 10,000 people. If everybody wants to become a Nobel laureate, to get a Nobel Prize for drug discovery, there will not be any drug discovery. You don't understand? So it's a team player. There are many players, there are many guys behind test cricketers, Dhonis and others who have contributed. But everybody doesn't get the same glory. I think, you know, that's what the reality of life is. Last, fourth, strategic communication. You communicate to the right people at the right time. The last but not the least, which is very relevant, is hardwiring the soft stuff. It is very easy sometimes to write these values, which I said, but it's very difficult how do you translate those values into actions. I given the example of integrated town hall meetings and employee satisfaction. Not doing per se as a ritual is not important, but you need to act and sustain it and enhance it and improve it. Hardwiring the soft stuff, translate values into action. So that's some of my top views on this, and I'm sure that others will be able to add more value to it. To conclude, there are four kinds of people. People who watch things happening, people who do not know what's happening, people to whom things happen, but distinguished minority are those who make things happen. I'm sure you are all in the distinguished category. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Prakarnath. I think you have given us a lot to think about, how we can reflect upon putting our beliefs into action and reflect upon what that the organization or the things we believe in are much greater than the individuals. I think Dr. Sunil Rai, you can please share your thoughts with us.
Once again, good morning to all of you. At the outset, I would like to place on record my very sincere thanks to IILM and Prime to give me this opportunity to be amongst you. It has been a treat yesterday, and I'm sure it's going to be like that today. Hearing the thoughts of Vilindaris and what a wonderful account which Dwarkanathji gave, 40 years of brilliance and all summarized in these 15 minutes. It's very difficult for anyone to follow after him. So, in any case, that's a normal thing with me. It's very difficult for me to talk sense for more than 2 minutes. My colleague Ranjini knows about it. So please bear with me, the youngsters, that I have this style of talking senselessly of some very senseful issues. This is the first issue is, and Dwarkanathji dwelled on it pretty well. What is ethics? And yesterday we heard, and one of the senior professors from IIM Bangalore, and we discussed that at the lunch table, said that don't teach, don't preach, because the moment you start putting something in curriculum, these youngsters start resisting it. But we teachers only know one thing, how to bind them into curriculum, and then give examination and give grades. That's the only thing which keeps us in business. So now what is this, what is ethics itself is a question. So let's dwell with some thoughts. As I said, that these will be stray thoughts. So is going on a date with an intimate partner ethical? I mean, in my generation, it was definitely considered unethical. The only way you could talk to a girl was to say she was my sister. Thankfully, things have changed. You can say who is who, right? When you go to Bombay and see on the Bombay Chowpatty, you find a lot of couples sitting on the other, facing the other side towards the seaside. But we call them cousins, because whenever the Hawaldar goes and asks them, they kya karta hai? So he says, Baji Bahin. You know, so they are the cousins. But there's nothing wrong in this. I think who will decide this? So going on a date with an intimate partner, definitely no problems. But going on a date with someone else's partner, now there is an issue. Someone of you would like to say first mover advantage, right? We talk to you about this in the business strategy, or it's competitive world. Come on, I win her over. But is it ethical? Is a question. Like you hear this mutual funds, thankfully now they have started. Previously the advertisements used to come. Whatever that fellow used to say in between the first picture till the things come, I could never hear it. But now I think they put some regulations. So you hear it. So tell all the risks and lose the prospect. And after all risks are not required for everybody. After all, there is such a wide section. So can I be tell only some crucial risks and attract proposals? Serve him or her well after that is again a question. So now, these are the kind of what are termed in literature as ethical dilemma. So some of these stories and some predictions. Cricket is a religion in India, right? Followed by almost everybody. So some examples of, let's say if you were to observe Sachin versus Vinod Kambli. Jonas, I'm sorry for the, because the cricket is not the part of American culture, but in India it's a religion. So many say that Vinod Kambli was 3 times more talented than Sachin Tendulkar. And which is true. Actually, his own coach actually admitted that. But you know what is Sachin and where he reached and where did Vinod Kambli reach. If you just take the fine print, it was all about what Dwarka Nathji said about the attitude. Attitude of excellence, attitude of winning, sincerity and being ethical and so on and so forth. And then another example comes to my mind is about Rahul versus Azharuddin. Azharuddin is the person who scored century in each of the 3 games that he started with. An outstanding talent. And then later on, we found him being named in match-fixing scandals and so on and so forth. But not about the Rahul Dravid. Rahul Dravid had been an epitome as far as ethical practices is concerned. And then in the corporate world, Dwarka Nathji talked about it. Actually, Satyam almost led the way. Frankly speaking, we do talk of whatever happened there. But let's give it to them that the outsourcing model or offshoring model was the gift of the IT world by Satyam. And they proved it that you can scale it up to the limits that India was then coming on the IT scene. So it's good, but where it lacked was, we all know about ethical practices. But the first three, you know that don't budge on that. And on infrastructure, Tata Power versus Reliance Energy. I've got police protection, so I can say that. Because speaking against Reliance, my goodness. And anyway, Kejriwal is doing something about it now. And today morning also he was saying that if it is not making business sense, then please don't do it here in Delhi. And so on and so forth. So I do not know. I put 2 question marks as to where would this go is a prediction which anybody can think about. And some thoughts. Dwarka Nathji dwelt on it in quite some detail between, there's a very fine line dividing between ambition and greed. So I'm not trying to suggest to youngsters that don't be ambitious. But then we have to understand that, and to understand this, I found a good example. There's this book called The Third Curve. Third Curve is written by Manzoor Khan. For youngsters, who's Manzoor Khan? The one who directed Qayamat Se Qayamat Tak. So I think now you know this particular person. In fact, after making it big, he has given up all his wealth and now he lives in the confines of Kunur and where he is contributing. But what he is saying there in this third curve is that except Brahman in our scriptures, which is Anant, because there is no end to that. But for the Brahman itself, for everything else, there is a limit. There is a limit to resources, and because output is a function of input, therefore there is a limit to even performance. So quarterly results, you keep on growing and you keep teaching about YOY, right? 5% double digit growth and so on and so forth. But all this actually has got a limit. But what has not got a limit is the human goodwill. There's no limit for that. That is also anant. And then there is some thoughts about mutually exclusive. I'm just talking this more from the youngster's perspective. Certain things are thought to be mutually exclusive.
But are they really mutually exclusive?
So they say, if you are sincere, you can't be enjoying. This guy is padaku kinds, you know, very sincere fellow. I am having a ball. Now who told you that if you are working hard, you cannot be enjoying? So I don't think these are mutually exclusive. You could do both. And same thing is true about progress and responsiveness. It's not true that when to make progress, you have to be irresponsible. If that was the case, DuPont wouldn't have been DuPont. GE wouldn't have been GE. The entire Tata Group wouldn't have been the Tata Group. Because they have made progress and they have been responsive. And then this big thought about consumption and contribution. And what's so great about spending? I can spend so much, I can consume so much. Ask the next question, what have you contributed? And that is where again DuPont comes to my mind. Because if there is one company which has ensured progress and ensuring that you do not deplete resources, it is this particular concern. Because in any other kind of manufacture, you will start depleting resources. The entire thing is about the creation of kind of material which will be heat resistant, shock resistant, and so on and so forth. The nylon, Teflon, all that you think of is an innovation by DuPont. Might sound like sales of DuPont, but well, that's a company which has lived for more than 120 years. And then this is important. There are no sacred cows. Many times students come and tell us also, this is the first mistake that I have done. Right? Before this, my record has been absolutely clean. Sometimes record was also absolutely clean till that happened. So your ethics is not a matter of choice. You have to continuously be at it. So our ethics rules are these guidelines, are these principles, are these values, or what are these? I think Dwarkanathji summed it all. It's a way of life. And then who decides that it is ethical? Is it the top management? Because these are not rules, so they can't set the rules for it. Or is it the middle management? Or is it the employees? Or is it regulators? Or is it society? You will agree with me? I think it's everybody's concern. Everyone, if they are not concerned, you can't have ethical practices. And the most important aspect is that business success is all about practicing admirable business ethics. And Dwarkanathji gave an excellent account of all those brilliant examples. So business ethics is basically practice. It has to be throughout the organization. Not on top, right throughout the organization. And you find this in companies like Tata Group companies, that there's a culture which is set in of ethics. So it's all about understanding actually what is ethics and what constitutes. And then it's quite possible to make ethical decisions, quite possible that while you're at that path, you will not make some out and out success in the short run. But in the long run, it's a business which is good for all, is an ethical business. And this wealth of satisfaction that you are contributing. So there was a study done by Does Business Ethics Pay? When I was talking about the mutual exclusivity, you can't be doing progress if you are not responsive. It's not true. The studies actually suggest otherwise. That those which have companies which have been ethical actually have outperformed both on top line as well as bottom line. And Harvard has actually reviewed 150 companies, Fortune 500 companies, over a 30-year window, and also have reviewed 150 CEOs. And I will talk about this. There is a theme which is coming about conscious capitalism, which is a cult now, which has become in the US. And they found that when they surveyed these 150 companies, the economist theory says that most of the organizations, the best organization lasts for, on an average, is 83 years. Right? So the life of an organization is 83 years on an average. This is, we are talking about good organization. And actually the success rate is anyway 3%. 97% do not succeed after inception. Now if these companies which have lived beyond 83 years, and they found that it was the companies and the CEOs, and there was a culture of ethics. GE, DuPont, Tata Group are all examples of those companies. And it doesn't make a very good story. It's like that Amir Khan talking about you know, so, India Mahan, and he talks about Atithi Devo Bhava, and then he gives the other picture. So in this survey, they had actually found out of a list of 138 organizations in the world which were considered high on ethics, there were only two Indian companies. And these are the two companies, Tata Steel and Wipro Limited. Dwarkaji talked about it. It's all about corporate governance, transparency, full accountability. That's Tata Steel for you. It's respect the rights of all its stakeholders and create an overall benefit for society. The whole concept of vendor power, looking after your suppliers, because that is something that organizations actually falter. We have to not only look at only from the customer side, that customer is the king. Yes, customer is the king. And that's where I'll quote the former CEO of HCL, Vineet Nair, whose book has actually made ripples in Harvard, which is called EFCS, Employees First, Customers Second, right? And he said, if your employees are happy and ethical, the rest of it falls in place. And Mr. Jain Tata himself, which Dwarkaji talked about, right? He talks about the foundation of prosperity is welfare of our employees, and Tata Group practices it. And this is the Wipro, which has been practicing business integrity, which has been practicing ecological sustainability and social community initiatives. So the mantra there is intensity to win. Dwarkaji talked about in his summary about those five things that he talked about: respect for others, act with sensitivity, and of course, unyielding integrity. In the long run, sustained success will only come from integrity. So why is it difficult to make ethical decisions? Because there are stakes involved. There is that quarterly reports, year-on-year progress reporting, and somebody talked, my other panelists are going to talk about this whole issue of reporting, and I learned from Jonas that they are actually putting together a nice framework about this reporting and comprehensive reporting standards in US. So what do we need to do? I think Peter Drucker has told us, ask the right questions. There are no right answers, there are only right questions. I thought I was tired. It's okay, all right. So the four important questions, ethical questions, is actually what is it all about, the ethics, where are we right now, and what it ought to be. So Dwarkaji talked about measurements. It's not just about laying down policies, having town halls. It's all about also having measurements. So what is it today and what it ought to be? If you have got this right, then of course you have to find out how do we get there. And what is our motivation for being, for acting ethically? There's only one motivation, which should be the organization's culture and organization's success. So the factors which affect the morality of managers, you know, firstly at the individual one's personal level, and the students will agree with me, placement season, I haven't got a good placement, problem. Becomes bigger problem when my friend gets it, right? So it's not what you didn't get, it's what others got it. So there's peer pressure, what you call it, the rules, and then of course you got to perform. There are targets, quarterly targets, monthly targets, right? There are superiors who are always breathing down, you are a useless fellow and things like that. You got to live with all these. And then there is it works at organizational level, at industry level, at business level, and profit maximization, consideration for all the stakeholders, culture, and of course, very important aspect, Dwarkaji mentioned also, it's all about leadership. Here is this one of the Michael Josephson Institute in US, where he just put down, this is more from the academic perspective as to what would be the ingredients of good management, education, and practice. So the points that need to be covered is about honesty and integrity. I'm referring to honesty of purpose. I'm referring to integrity of individual organization and industry level integrity. The keeping promise which Dwarkaji talked about, the loyalty to your customers, to society, fairness, caring, respect for others, very importantly, law abiding, filling your income tax returns, paying your service taxes in time, and so on and so forth. Commitment to excellence, which was also covered by Dwarkanarji, exemplary leadership. Above all, the reputation. It is this which is there on the balance sheet of the company, which is the most important asset. Reputation and morale, and of course, accountability to all. And if you're doing that, then of course, you have got your ethical principles right as far as business is concerned. Thanks for your patience.
Thank you, Dr. Rai. I think you have given us a lot to think about, to check our thought processes, to do a lot of self-reflection, and we really need to question ourselves as to where we stand on the about ethics. Thank you very much. So, Dr. Ranjan.
Inclusive growth, when they get an opportunity to present it to the public, that is the non-financial reporting. We believe that the corporations have grown at the cost of the society has led to the growing demand from the public, which is the generic society, as to the non-financial reporting aspects for the organization. Stakeholders, we saw this yesterday also, has changed over a period of time. Initially, it used to be limited to the shareholders of the organization. But over a period of time, people realized that we also need to have happy employees, happy customers, suppliers, and the government. But overall, since the society is a major stakeholder, because losses are public, so society is also absorbing the losses of the organization. The need of the society to get to know what the organization is doing, what is the resources that they are consuming, and are they going to be sustainable, is the requirement that drives the need for non-financial reporting. The framework that we have for financial reporting, which is any new company which starts an organization, very clearly knows the due dates for filing the reports. The formats are prescribed in the Companies Act. However, when it comes to non-financial reporting, there's not much framework that's available in India. Globally, companies are following the GRI reporting framework, but in India, it's still in a very evolving phase where its standard doesn't exist. SEBI, by enclosing clause 55 in the listing agreement, has included the business responsibility reporting, and this has been made mandatory for the top 100 listed companies from the year 2012-13. Apart from the top listed 100 companies basis market capitalization, it is also voluntary for the other companies. So they made it mandatory for the 100 listed companies, but then for others they have said that it's voluntary. If you want, you can go ahead and report it. A few principles that's there in the BRR report. This actually tells about what sustainability all about is. Sustainability is not just the environment or the CSR, but then if you see here, it starts from ethics, the product that the organization is giving, the well-being of employees, stakeholder engagement, the human rights if the organization is respecting that, respecting the environment, and in case they are degrading the environment, what is done by the company to restore it back, the policy advocacy, if they are engaged in doing public advocacy, they have to be doing that in a responsible manner, inclusive growth of the entire community, and value to the customers. So all organizations are required to report on these 9 principles as to what is the organization doing about this. The objective of the study is to find the level of sustainability reporting in the selected sample. What is driving the companies to report? Based on the initial literature review, the possible factors that came out were, is it the sector that they are operating? Is it the size of the organization? Is it the role of the authority, the regulators, or the auditors of the company? Who is influencing? What is making the companies report on the non-financial aspect? The first aspect, the sector, literature review states that companies which are in oil and mining utilities, those which are environmentally sensitive organizations, are reporting, which means companies which are using non-renewable resources probably feel the need to report. Maybe they understand that they are, you know, using the resources, and then ethically they feel they should be reporting. The next aspect is on the size of the firm. There's a strong association between the size of the firm, which is the larger organizations are continuing to report, whereas smaller organizations are not. But the negative impact to this is organizations only report the good news. The bad news is never reported. So when it is voluntary, organizations continue to report, but then the good news. So should it be made mandatory or should it be keeping it voluntary? Again, two schools of thoughts. Those who are in for mandatory reporting state that the countries which have mandatory reporting requirements, the quality and the quantity of reporting continues to be great. However, when it comes to the sustainability reporting, the other school says that the core value, which is the social consciousness, has to come from within. An external regulator can't tell you as to what is to be reported. So the main aim of sustainability, which comes from within, is lost when it is made mandatory. So there are two school of thoughts when it comes to should it be mandatory or should it be voluntary and left to the organizations. However, the literature also says that when voluntary reporting fails, then probably it has to be made mandatory so that the organizations start reporting on the sustainability. The next is the impact of the assurance provider. Strong relationship between the characteristics of the assurance provider, which is the size of the organization, versus the international presence. So in the study that I have done, I have classified the audit firms into big four and non-big four audit firms. Big four audit firms have global exposures, so they would probably have exposure doing sustainability reporting outside India, which gives them the expertise. One of the literature review also states that it's a challenging job for the auditors because all through these years, they have been reporting the financial aspect. So the expertise lies in auditing the financial statements. But when it comes to giving guidance to the client on non-financial reporting, they themselves are at loss as to they do not have the required skill to be doing this. Next is the sample size, 60 companies. 30 of them were the BSE 30 companies, which are large companies, and 30 companies from the BSE Small Cap Index, which are the small-sized company, comprising of all the sectors and representing two different sizes. The reporting habit for the year 2012-13, this is the year in which the business responsibility reporting was made mandatory for the BSE 30 companies. The reports were all available on the public domain of these organizations, both the annual report and the standalone sustainability report. These reports were studied, and the report basically, the research concentrated on the sector, the type of reporting, the size of the organization, role of the assurance provider, and the should it be mandatory or voluntary. Findings and recommendations. The red lines are the companies which are not reporting, and the blue are the ones which are reporting. Contrary to the literature review, which states that organizations which are in the mining and drilling refineries, probably environmentally sensitive organizations, are reporting. But that doesn't seem to be the case in the sample that is studied, because we see some of them are reporting, some of them being in the same industry, they are not reporting. Further analysis of this data shows that it's the size which is more important, and it's the sector which is not actually important. Here, the graph, the top bar is the small sized companies and the next one is the larger organizations. Small cap companies again are not reporting when it comes to voluntary sustainability. Only five of them are reporting, whereas when it comes to larger organizations, 23 of them are reporting. So what is it that is making them report? It's the large organizations which seem to be reporting. When it comes to mandatory reporting, all of them are reporting, which just indicates that law is complied with, there is compliance to law. So in the Indian perspective, probably we have to look at what is to be done, should it be mandatory or voluntary. This is the role of the assurance provider. Literature review said that assurance provider have a strong hold on non-financial reporting, but the research doesn't indicate that. Again, it's the size which is seemingly to be important in relation to the reporting aspect. So there's no significant correlation between the assurance provider also. So since science is the only factor which is impacting non-financial reporting or the sustainability reporting, the conclusion that is drawn is maybe the large size organizations have understood the benefit. Maybe they are global companies, so since they are listed outside, they have the pressure from companies outside. It could also be because it's a way they want to disseminate the good work that they are doing, and they want the entire society to know they are doing. Maybe they are in the public eye, that which makes them manage the brand, so they have to report on the sustainability. Or it could also be because of pressure from the competitors. If your competitors are reporting, you are also required to report. Or maybe they have enough resources to report, because there's a cost aspect also which comes into when you are reporting. The recommendation that has been given is maybe the regulatory body should make it mandatory for all organizations to at least start reporting, because what get measured is what get done. At least let's start measuring, and then we can see if the sustainability aspect is getting done or not. And the next is the limitations. The study is done only on the first set of reports that the companies have provided. Mid-cap companies can be included to see what is the mid-size organizations doing in relation to the reporting. And the quality of the report has not been studied, which is the content analysis. All that I have studied is, are they reporting or not reporting? The study can then be extended to include the quality of reporting in the further years. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rajani. Our second paper is by Mr. Sudipto.
We have focused on the compliance of the principles, how the companies are complying those principles after being the member of the United Nations Global Compact. So this is the methodology. Following different methodology, there are basically two parts. One is a qualitative content analysis, another quantitative content analysis. Quantitative in the sense that the reporting, non-financial reporting like sustainability reporting, corporate social responsibility reporting, all such different types of non-financial reporting content subjective information as well as objective or quantitative information. So we have segregated quantitative information. Quantitative information is selected in the sense that a company, how it is considering the principles in their business, and after that how the companies are performing actually. Those are presented through the objective data, and that content is analyzed, counted. After conducting such study, what we have found, consistently better performances is found from the different countries in ACL. Among them, basically four countries have priority: Korean, Indian, Japanese, and Chinese companies. Whereas other companies are performing not that much better. But all the sample companies have their increasing tendency to perform objective as well as subjective information over the years. Over the years, in the sense that I have selected my sample from 2009 to 2012. reporting. Next, it is found that emphasis given on the actual social performance activities. Actual in the sense that, as I said, considering the policies, that is different issue, and after considering the policy, applying it. So, in that way, on the basis of objective data collected, what we have found that among the different Asian countries, Korea, Japan, India and Chinese, as well as Singapore, they have better performances. They are emphasizing on the quantitative reporting disclosure of their non-financial performances. Next, we have found that the member companies are also emphasizing on the social activities. Social activity, there is something important to be noticeable. As we are starting our study from 2009, so what we have found that 2009-10, there is emphasis on the environmental reporting, economic performance reporting, such issues. But whenever we are taking a trend, considering a trend that from 2009 to 12, what we have found that this labor issue, social issue, and product responsibility issue. Product responsibility issue, social issue, all such performances are counted by the GRI performance indicator, GRI G3. So, by considering those GRI G3 performance indicator, what we have found that social activities are being emphasized over the year. So, other than economic issue, environmental issues, the companies are performing those issues better way, objectively as well as subjectively. But in the recent years, after 2010-11-12, we have found that the companies are performing their social activities, they are focusing on social activities for the betterment of the community, etc. Now, there is another data what is I would like to focus on, that in the UNGC website, if you will check it, you will find that so many companies are joining the UNGC, but so many companies are not performing their activities properly. So there is a segregation. You will find it that companies are joining, after joining they are staying inactive. So many companies joining, but they are staying inactive because maybe for some reason. So I would like to conclude something from the findings. Except some selective countries like Korea, Japan, China, India, the overall role played by the other sample companies in Asia are not at its best. Next, in the starting of the another decade, that is after 2010, it is found that the social issues like labor, social related means community development, and product responsibility related issues are being focused. There is an increasing trend in the actual performances of sample companies in terms of objective disclosure, and it means that the companies are starting to emphasize on the actual performances, as well as they are also disclosing their policies in their report. And several of the member companies are performing their citizenship role with marginal activities. Now this is important to write here, because I have taken almost 500 companies. Now, after searching their website specifically, what I have found that the sample reduced to 122 companies, where I have found countable data for analysis purpose. So, from there I can say that there are so many companies which are taking membership in UNGC. There are so many companies which are showing that they are performing their citizenship role, corporate social performances, but the ultimate result is this. I have some recommendations like there is the necessity in the change of corporate attitude of joining Global Compact, where the member companies are not supposed to join UNGC. Now this conclusion is given in different way. If you will take a look to the KPMG report on CSR 2011 as well as Communication and Progress report, there the studies, the survey report is showing that the most of the member companies who are joining UNGC, they are basically focusing on, they have their priority on brand value creation, on reputation and economic performances, economic stability, where the social issue is staying in the next to last or maybe second from the last position. So the priority in the social issue is very much less focused from the study results. So that is why I said here that there is a need to change the attitude of the companies regarding just following the principle and applying it. Companies are applying it or they are expecting their own benefit much more. The second is that the company stakeholder can be informed about the company's inactiveness, including the reason behind it. Now, in the findings, as I said, that several of the companies are staying inactive. So, this inactiveness can be informed to the stakeholder or maybe published to the public media so that the people can be aware about the company's real performances with respect to the CSR, consideration of CSR policies and performing it actually. And last of all, it may be suggested that the Asian companies are in need to play their citizenship role as real citizen with proper governance. Now these are also the suggestion of different writers. Mr. Booch in 2009 suggested that corporate governance is like glue, which is very important for proper corporate citizenship performances. So, and basically as we know that corporate governance is full of different principles which are to be applicable for the betterment of company's performances. So, that's all from my study. I would like to suggest to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sudipto. You know, I'm working on my PhD and my guide told me that don't get too tense about your thesis presentation because you're throwing us some jargon, throwing some fancy words, and it will, you'll appreciate it more. Nobody will appreciate it more than you. So anyway, I have a paper presentation from my thesis only. I will go through it very fast. And I've made it very simple also. This deals with the factors that really affect technology acceptance. With a focus on RFID technology, that's what I'm working on. Basic introduction to, I'm sure RFID has been around for some time and most of you must be aware of it. But anyway, RFID or radio frequency identification is a technology comprising of tags and sensors that has provided the world with high level of accuracy and security, making it ideal for data collection. RFID technology allows for the identification, data collection and information storage on assets and goods. An ideal RFID system is one that enables low cost implementation of data transfer without any need for human intervention. Radio frequency readers can read at a distance without any need for line of sight, scanning or physical contact. Objectives of the study: to examine individuals' acceptance behavior towards RFID applications within the retail supply chain context. The factors that influence, influence of organizational factors, technology policies, top management support, and then technological constructs like advantages and compatibility, environmental constructs like information insensitivity, intensity, and competitive pressure, and government support.
Retailers adopting RFID technology are looking for ways to increase visibility and traceability, reduce out-of-stock scenarios, and reduce labor costs. The technology's high level of accuracy and security makes it ideal for data collection in retail sector. Decisions to accept any technology needs an equal consideration of the individual's prerequisites as well as the groups of which one is a member. Various factors play a role in the decision-making process, in the technology selection, implementation, and usage, which can impact the outcome significantly. It can be inferred that it can only influence the intention and use when intrinsic characteristics of technology contribute to the actual usage. That is, perceived ease of use can only influence the intention and use when intrinsic characteristics of technology contribute to the actual usage. The review of literature and the formation of conceptual framework, there were several models that we looked into, and what we finally narrowed down was to the technology acceptance model. This has emerged as a robust theoretical model due to its parsimonious structure and acceptable explanatory fit. The TAM posits that behavior beliefs, that is perceived usefulness and perceived ease of use, affect acceptance intention, and primarily based on the conceptualization of social cognitive theory, according to which there is a consistent reciprocal relationship between environmental factors, personal factors, and behavior. Nature of the study and data collection, it was a cross-sectional study, meaning the different people at different stages of their working were analyzed and surveyed. A non-probability sampling method is chosen to collect the data, which is much more accurate and realistic. Individual employees working in retail organizations were surveyed, and the survey method was a questionnaire, and the sample was tested using a Mann-Whitney U-test, meaning the questionnaire is tested with respect to the reversing the questions or making the different sections appear in different sequence, just to ensure that the surveyor, the person filling out the survey, doesn't wean away at the end of the questionnaire. So that test was analyzed as well. For data analysis, sequential equation modeling was used. This is a sample survey. I don't know if you can see it, but about 400 people were surveyed, and they were categorized based upon gender, age, occupational positions, experience, educational level, and type of organization. Findings. Perceived ease of use impact is stronger when the users have less experience and the technology is more complex to use. Relationship between low-level management, that is departmental support, was positively significant with respondents' behavioral beliefs. Individuals were much influenced by their immediate supervisors due to their day-to-day communication compared with top management. Results suggest that the intentions of the respondents who held a higher position to accept technology were solely based on the perception of instrumental outcome, that is perceived usefulness, while entry-level respondents' acceptance intention was based upon perceived ease of use. Less educated individuals possess insufficient knowledge, greater anxiety, and less sophisticated cognitive structures to learn new things. Consequently, they are one of the main barriers towards the acceptance of technology. Significant impact of higher education on the perceived ease of use, as less educated people would find technology cumbersome and strenuous to learn. Areas of concern: erroneous usage of technology for those who are not proficient with it, lack of incentive to start working with technology, those who are averse to it, due to inappropriate job assignments, less capable people are entrusted to deal with technology, which is a setback. Possibility of manipulation by lower level management in absence of checks, since the ground level employees are more apt to listening to them rather than the higher level management. Inaccurate transactions leading to losses and customer dissatisfaction. Inaccurate inventory management and low employee motivation. Finally, the recommendations, well-planned HRIS system, like a human resource information system, which should be able to connect and incorporate all different aspects within the single system to help in making decisions. Greater transparency, scheduled trainings and opportunities for skill upgrading, and timely feedback and surveys, and well-defined processes. Thank you. We have a few minutes to take in a few questions. Let me start with one question myself. Will the emerging culture of openness and transparency create concerns for the private sector with respect to HR policies? We have either one of you.
Can I just ask you a counter question, Professor? why only HR policies? I think the corporate policies.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely.
I think it can always cause a concerns who do not want to follow the principles of ethics, governance, transparency and all that. And secondly, there are people, I was just reading a quote, which good people do not need laws to tell them to act responsibly, while bad people will always find a way around the law, Plato. Okay, I think, these are all mindset issues. Whether you have a policy or not, you can have a policy and you don't have to follow. And sometimes you make the policies to comply with laws. I'll give you one or two examples here, since you raised the HR policies. There is a provision in the Companies Act, talked about disclosures and all. There is a provision in the Companies Act which says the managerial remuneration. This most of the topics which comes for debate from HR is on the managerial remuneration. Others are financials. What is the salary paid to the managing director or the CEO? What are the salaries paid to the top management? Is it in line with the market competition, competitive environment? Are they paid, overpaid but underpaid for others? This is one of the issues which comes up, where the greed and other things have started coming, misuse of the position, nepotism and so on. You see, 272A is a reference of the Companies Act, of the old Act, which still holds good. But, most of the people do not disclose the remuneration of others other than the executive directors and the board directors of the company. And they said, if you want an enclosure as an attachment, if you want, you please ask, we'll give it. So why? If you are a transparent and open, disclose. You are taking under the umbrage of law saying, okay, if you ask, I will give it, otherwise I will not give it. I think that is the problem. Why do you want to have, you can have guiding principles, you can have laws, you can have rules, you can have standing orders. But the issue is, do you have intentions? Credibility comes from you have a good intent to disclose, be transparent and open and prepared to, you said, respect for others' views, sir. I think this is where, are you willing, if somebody raises you, are you willing to accept it or you duck it? So that is the question. I think, it's a more to do with the culture of the organization. It is the leadership, which from the top, which has been said. And I think the other things just follow. I think, it's very easy to implement, but at the same time, it's also difficult to make it implementable if the leaders are not willing to follow.
Thank you, Mr. Rao.
I just like to add to Gautanaji's comment and the question that you had raised was about, he corrected actually, why only HR policies and why not total corporate policies? And of course, you raised the question for the corporates. Lest my young friends here misunderstand, I just like to anecdotically say that everybody born in Ayodhya is not Ram. And from the same token, everybody born in Lanka is not Ravana. These good policies, and that's what Gautanaji said, good people are good people. So this, all issues of performance, reporting, responsiveness is an issue which pervades all walks, whether it's private or corporate sector.
frankly speaking, the irregularities that have been found, because the public sector actually is rule bound, percentage wise you might find lesser irregularities there. I do not have any concrete data on that. But we should not demarcate, because ethical is an all-pervasive issue. It's not sectoral, and it's not also by any kind of organization.
Just to add, you know, you said private. Mm-hmm. But see, Tata's is a great example. It's a private organization. It's not a public sector. We all quote it. And secondly, I think the students are there. It's important in talking about ethics and HR policies. They just, if you allow me, see the PowerPoint presentations when they come for campus interviews. It's a case for example in terms of ethics. I have been dealt with it for 35 years. It's a competition. I should get first day, first slot in Excel or wherever it is, ILM. And you know, because of that, how to beat my competitor? Cost to company, to the students. Students are naive. They do not understand. 10 crores. I'm saying, example, I used to give in my days, 9 lakhs. He said he accepted. When you get the first pay slip, you find that is 60% of it. Then can you please explain why? This includes your travel cost. It includes your training cost. You includes your hostel cost. I said, be transparent and open. Why? I wanted to beat my competitor, but so I make it 9 because that man is giving 8.5. Actually, you're giving 7. These are simple things. You don't have to go into the great financial reporting and governance and compliance. This is something what students will understand. This is what you are saying as a HR director from a platform. This is what I offer you and ultimately what I get. So this is what important aspects, I think. This is where we need to bring that change. You need to bring at all levels. It's not at a transformation level, but even at a transaction level.
I think you have made a very realistic and a practical issue which I think a lot of the students face. So we can take a few questions from the audience.
Hello. This is about Mr. Dwarkanath, please respond to this. You said that ambitious or greed, you know, could lead to unethical practices. Is that right?
Sir, actually I didn't say it.
You
he, okay. Slide was showed by him. I talked about greed.
Okay, I don't think you. I agree with you.
Because the advantage is
I. No, I don't agree with both of you then. Because I would say that ambition or greed is nothing to do with ethics. It has to do with the objectives of the organization, which normally are aligned with the commitments that they have for different stakeholders, and. Even the best of the businesses I know of, they have been growing very well, much higher than the industry averages, without compromising on our ethics. In fact, they actually have set standards on ethics. So ambition or greed has nothing to do with ethics.
Sir, I need to challenge you, because you can't get away like this.
Yes.
Because this is an open and transparent environment.
Absolutely.
I talked about greed. Okay,
yes.
I'm not talking about ambition.
Yes.
I don't agree with you. You said greed is profitability is different from greed. Profiteering. You are talking. If I say profiteering, then I have an issue. Making profits. I would always say as a corporate, I've been spent 40 years. Without profits, you can't sustain. You can't survive. Making profits is not greed. Please, greed is something beyond profits for your own self-interest at the cost of the organization, which is in line not with the values of the organization. We talked about Lehman Brothers and Enron's. This is what we are talking about, greed. It is not making profits. Tatas have to make profits. It doesn't mean that the people are greed and they are unethical. So I think, you see, the overall, you have to see from a broader perspective when you are talking about ethics. Ethics consists of various components here. I think we are giving an example. If you are too greedy, and your interest, it is not organization as hero, but your personal interest overrides the organization. Greed doesn't mean only earning, enriching yourself. Greed is in terms of power. Greed is misuse of power. Greed is showing nepotism as well. So those aspects we need to avoid. Power by itself is not wrong. Politics by itself is not wrong. But how do you manifest it and use it is the most critical.
Sir, but in an organization, business ethics normally flow down the organization. It is not the person at the ground level who determines their ethics. It is the people at the top who determine their ethics.
I am talking about the leaderships.
And therefore, if you are talking about greed or ethics, it is not on an individual basis, it is on an organizational basis.
But ultimately, the role modelship comes from the leader.
That's right.
Leader walks the talks.
Yes.
If Jardy has not followed that preach, Tatas wouldn't have been here.
Yes.
That's what I say.
Yes. But greed, if you're talking about numbers in greed, greed is not definable in that manner.
I don't want to what Varkar said. Thank you, sir, for defending me there. But I did not say about ethics, aspiration, and greed. I said in my slide, I did talk about as a very thin line dividing aspiration and greed. And this is basically implementation of those policies with the top principle. Now, of course, the squarely the responsibility of what goes on in the organization. He mentioned about the success of the missile program, right? It is squarely the leader. So leadership is important. But for youngsters who are now walking into their corporate life, you know, they would be confronted with n number of situations where this fine line divide they will have to challenge. And which is what was, as teachers, was our aim, that this future of the nation should do this well. And I said it yesterday during lunch, that I have no doubts about that in my mind, with due respect to all my elders, that something we didn't do right in our generation and generation minus one. I have a lot of hope on this generation. And if they take care of these things, there's nothing stopping us.
I have a little softer question. Varkanath ji, you know, you have also mentioned that when a product succeeds, everybody takes the credit, and when a product fails, you tend to push the buck somewhere else. So therefore, in the present system, there's a strong tendency to push the problem upwards to be solved at a higher level of the organization. Now, to solve someone else's problem is one of the greatest disservice one can do to a fellow human being. Now, don't you think he who owns the problem is the solution? And that is where the leadership style is going to be in the future, because in the Western countries, we see this happening. And as a corollary to that, Konosuke Matsushita of National Panasonic, who happens to, and that is one of the longest living companies so far, had made a statement that if you can't think about employees first, how can you think about customers first? That is a very, very profound statement. It used to be there in our office those days.
Sir, I totally agree. I think, you know, I'm not differing with you, nor I mean to say it in any different way. I think, you know, Professor has referred about Vinit's Nayar's book, somebody referred, customer, you know, people first, employee first, then customer next. This is a, you know, I as a HR professional, I think it depends on the sector to some extent. Customer is, employee is also a key customer, there's no question about it. But if you say in the service sector, which I'm associated with in the Max Group, be it in the hospitals, be it in the insurance sector, if you're getting into the hospital first, I think, you know, it is the way the reception or the gateman handles you is more important, or the way your discharge administrative paramedical support is more important, apart from the clinician or the surgeon. So if you are not motivated, you can't get the best service. Similarly, the airline or hospitality industry, it all goes. I think, you know, the issue which I talked about with specific reference to product is, when the product, you see, I totally agree, the accountability rests with the leader. There is no question about it. He may delegate or he may empower, but the accountability rests with the leader. What I said was, when the product is succeeded, the leader takes the credit. When the product fails, leader will try to push the blame on someone else in the team. That's what I meant. That is where I quoted Professor Satish Dhawan. When the missile failed, launch failed, he took the blame. But actually, when, you know, he took the blame, that was his leadership. But you know, when it succeeded, he gave the entire credit to Abdul Kalam. That is an exceptional case. That is an outstanding leadership. But I'm saying those are the people. But ultimately, the buck stops with the person who is accountable and responsible. And unfortunately, when you're talking about ethics and governance, that accountability and responsibility, be it in public or sector or in the government sector or in the private sector, is lacking. We always try to figure out how to pass on the blame to someone else.
I'm afraid we are going overboard. So as far as time is concerned, because the next session is also scheduled, it's time for a break. But I would like to thank all our panelists, Mr. Dwarkanath, Dr. Sunil, Mr. Mandal, Dr. Ranjini. Thank you very much.